That was then and this is now. Mondays at 7 on CBC Television.
Hi, I'm Justin Hayward.
And I'm John Lodge of the Moody Blues.
Hi, this is Richard Marx.
Hi, this is Tiffany. Have you heard the news? There's good rockin' tonight.
Plus, brand new Tiffany trivia, videos from Bros, Cindy Lauper, and the Striper Contest winners on show number 269 of Good Rockin' Tonight. Brought to you by Coors and Coors Light. A great call every time.
Hi, everybody. I'm Huey Lewis. Have you heard the news?
And the news is that there's new news, a brand new Huey Lewis in the News album called Small World. Hi, everyone. I'm Stu Jeffries, and welcome to tonight's show, which includes interviews with the Moody Blues, Richard Marx, and Tiffany.
The acceptance of the tunes, because that's really what it's about, you know. I mean, rock, and anybody who's ever been moved by a song, and I have, and I know you have, I think that really is the magic, you know, is in the song. And to create a song that takes on a life of its own is really a thrilling thing. And you never know while you're doing it whether it's going to sort of fly or not. But we have made a couple, you know, and that's really gratifying.
When Richard Marx came on the scene with his self-titled debut last year, you know, I don't think anyone could have foreseen the successes he'd achieve, including three top five singles. Moving up fast is single number four, and it's a ballad. Richard talks about the David Foster connection.
David Foster and I met in 1983 when I moved to Los Angeles. He was, before I had moved to California when I was growing up in Chicago, David was one of my heroes. I mean, I loved every record that he was involved in as a writer, as a producer, as an arranger, or anything. And so I really wanted to work with him, and some mutual friends put us together, and we became real good friends, and we ended up writing songs together for Kenny Rogers and Chicago, and he involved me in a lot of projects that he worked on. And it also gave me a chance to sort of sit next to him while he produced these records. And he gave me an amazing amount of his time and just let me hang with him for a long time. And a lot of people have asked, because a lot of people do know about my relationship with him, why he wasn't involved with my album after all this time. And the truthful answer, sorry, David, you gotta cop to this, is I was at a point right before I got signed to the record deal where I was really frustrated because I really wanted to make my own record, as a lot of people do. And I went to David and I said, look, I've never asked you this, but is there anything that you can do to maybe help me get a record deal? And he said, I can't do that because you're never going to make it as an artist. And I went, what? And he said, in my opinion, you're going to be a successful producer, and you're already a good songwriter, but you're never going to have a hit record as a singer, because you just don't have it. And so I went home and bandaged my wrists after I'd slit them, and then I got signed. And I didn't, when it came time to do the record, I didn't want to ask David Foster to be involved with the record, because I wanted somebody involved with my record that really believed in me, that really believed that I could have a hit record. So, and also the other reason is that David, as brilliant as he is, his music has gone in a direction that I'm not really interested in, which is really mellow, sort of beautifully produced and orchestrated elevator music, if you will. I mean, it's real mellow. It's great for what it is. And I'm more interested in rock and roll. And David's not a rock and roll guy. So it was nothing personal. It was nothing. I mean, I owe him a great deal of respect, and he has it. But when it came time for my own record, I had to do things my own way. So that's the David Foster connection.
Still to come, lots of contests, an interview with the Moody Blues, and a talk with Tiffany. And if she could do a duet with anyone in the whole world, who would she choose?
If I were going to do a duet with someone, it would have to be Rod Stewart or Stevie Nicks. That's what I would like. Well, I think Rod Stewart's very attractive, first of all, and Stevie Nicks has inspired me.
England is a curious place. It's one or the other. You know, they're either very critical, or then they have Top of the Pops, the heaviest bubblegum shows in the world, and then the heaviest sort of critics, and it's one or the other. But we do gigs there, and we do quite well, actually. You know, we play proper venues and so on. Well, but the biggest hit we've ever had was If This Is It, which just barely went top 40.
When will I be famous?
When will he be famous? Well, Huey's won a BPI award since that interview in the land that's now giving us the latest haircut of the week. Matt, Luke, and Craig, collectively known as Bros. They are all of 19 years old and already find themselves with two top five UK hits, Drop the Boy, and this one, When Will I Be Famous? Judging by the success of their videos and debut album, looks like you're already there, guys. You know, after our Tiffany interview a few weeks back, we received a whole pile of letters from Tiff fans who were a little more than disappointed in our failure to show a complete video. Well, the fact is, we didn't have her latest video at the time to show you, but now we do. Heck, we'll even give you a little more of Tiffany in person. Now, I want you also to stand by for a brand new Tiffany trivia contest to win autographed posters, too, okay? Tiffany, you know, you toured England recently. I'm interested to know what your impressions were.
I liked London a lot. Very busy. There's some nice stores there, in fact. But overall, I didn't get to see that much. I was there on a promotion tour, or a promotion visit, actually. So I didn't get to see that much. But just walking down the street and talking to some of the people, I liked it a lot. I had a chance to meet some of the up-and-coming new stars and just hear about some of the, you know, people. I guess the Beatles were supposedly from Liverpool. And I went to Liverpool, and it was kind of a neat feeling just to be driving around thinking, you know, they probably walked down this very same street or whatever. So it was very exciting for me.
You know, you're in essence a role model for a lot of the nation's youth. How do you handle that responsibility?
I've heard a lot of people, as far as parents, say, I think you're a good role model for my daughter. I haven't heard any boys yet, but that's okay. I don't think that I started out saying, I'm going to be a role model. I didn't think of that. It doesn't bug me, though. I think I was elected into the club somehow. But as far as, it doesn't put any pressures on me. I just do what I feel comes out of my heart.
What can you tell me about your next album, Tiffany?
Well, we're two songs into the new album, so I don't really have an opinion on it yet of what it's actually going to sound like. But there's a remake. There's going to only be one called Ain't Gonna Eat Out My Heart Anymore, which was recorded by the Rascals. And there's a ballad called All This Time. So I hope that I have a wonderful response from the new album as I did the last one.
Still to come, your chance to win Tiffany autographed posters. But up next, it's John and Justin of the Moody Blues. Don't go anywhere. Hard to believe, but you know, it has been 21 years since we heard Days of Future Past and the unforgettable Nights in White Satin. Since that time, the Moody Blues has sold over 50 million records worldwide and now find themselves playing to two generations of Moody fans. The brand new album is called Sur la Mer.
Our audience started evolving around the time of, we had an album called Long Distance Voyager, which got to number one all over the world, and that album introduced so many new people to the Moody Blues music who just weren't aware of the history, you know, that the band had before that. And since that album, we've really seen the audience evolve, a lot of younger people coming to the concerts. So the audience is very diverse, goes right across the range.
I think, yeah, the compact disc, of course, has, you know, really changed the picture for the Moodys. When we recorded all our albums, like Days of Future Past was recorded on a four-track machine. In Search of the Lost Chord was on a four-track machine. So when you talk about 48 track machines now, you're talking a different world altogether. But what we did when we finished the album, we always did a stereo mix, un-EQ'd, and we put that away to one side. and then we used EQ'd masters after that. So when the compact discs came out, we just found the original two tracks on EQ'd masters, digitally mastered them again for the compact disc. Mm-hmm. And that's what you hear on the album now. And I think what's happening, the new people who are coming for the Moody Blues are taking up the compact discs, and they're listening to all the Moodys now, going back, 20 years.
We had a deal with the record company where whenever we went in the studio, we'd take over the whole place, and we'd have every instrument of the orchestra. It was really like pampered kids, you know. Wow. We'd have every instrument of the orchestra in the studio. So that if we fancied just learning a little piece of something, you know, on a harp or a cello or a trumpet or a xylophone or something.
They were there.
They were there, and you could learn just enough to make the particular few bars that you wanted. But it was becoming impossible to... It was also taking us ages to make albums, but...
There was another reason for the length of time as well, let's be honest. We decided to have a soccer team.
Ah, OK, all right.
Very self-indulgent, really.
The studio next door to our studio was the big orchestral studio where Mantovani used to record.
It's the largest studio in London, yeah.
And it was a perfect five-a-side pitch. I am sorry, it was a... the booth that the orchestra leaders used to use was just about the size of a soccer net. So we used to have those either end of the studio. And we used to play soccer. If we got stuck on a particular passage, we'd say, soccer!
Soccer.
So we'd wander into the studio, and we literally used to have... I mean, people used to come... Everybody used to turn up for miles over there for our soccer games. 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, there was a soccer game going on in the studio. And I remember once that the caretaker of the studios, Sid, decided he'd had enough. You know, I mean, these guys wandering around pretending
long
to be musicians, long-haired lads, causing all this trouble. So he had a meeting with the directors and I think the chairman of the record company to report on what was going on. And the chairman said, listen, if that's what they need...
That's what these boys need, you know, to sell 3 million records.
He said, send them some soccer balls.